Praise Yah, everybody. Hallelujah. We're going to be reading our Torah reading right now. If you want to open up your scriptures and read along with me. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. So we're reading the Torah, and we're looking at the Torah portion for this week. And the Torah reading for this week was Genesis 41, 1 to 44, 17. And we're up to chapter 43. And as we saw last week, we saw the story of Joseph and his brothers continue. We saw what's going on with that. We saw Joseph being restored to the position, or not being restored, made into the position of the second in command in Egypt. But they shaved him and they changed his clothes. And the brothers came down for food and they didn't recognize him. And they told him that they had another brother, a younger brother, which was actually Joseph's full brother, his only full brother. And they told him to bring him back or not to show their face again. And the father, Jacob, had no choice. No choice. But to send him. When we look at the end of chapter 38, he says, "My son shall not go down." Chapter 42, with you, for his brother is dead, and he is alone, alone he is left. And if harm should happen to him in the way which you go, you would be bring down by gray hair in sorrow to the grave. So now we find ourselves looking more at the chapter, and it starts off, the famine was severe in the land. The famine was severe in the land. And this is an interesting phrase. The famine was severe. Well, how could it not be severe? Famine is famine, right? There's either food, there is no food. But the difference is there might be famine in the land, but there could be hope on the horizon. Maybe they knew food was coming soon. So even though there was famine, it wasn't severe because there's food right around the corner. But here, there's no food in sight. The famine was in the land, was very severe. By this time, the flock and all the things that Jacob had are probably getting dwindling down. As they're eating their cattle, the famine was severe in the land, and the only one that had the solution was Joseph, but they didn't know he was the Joseph. So it's very interesting how this plays out. Jacob was set in chapter 42, verse 38, "My son shall not go down with you." He was clear and set that was not going to happen. But the famine was severe. So look how his mind had to change, or he had to do something. He had to change something. He didn't want his son to go down at all. It's the last thing he wanted. But verse 2 says, "And it happened when they had finished eating the grain which they had brought from Egypt, their father said to them, 'Go back and buy a little food for us.' And Judah spoke to him, saying, 'The man fiercely repeated and gave us a warning, and saying to us, "You shall not see my face unless your brother is with you. And if you are sending our brother with us, we will go down and buy food for you. And if you are not sending, we will not go. For the man said to us, "You shall not see my face unless your brother is with you." And Israel said, "Why did you do evil for me and tell the man you still had a brother?" So this verse, there's a lot going on in this verse. First of all, they called his name Israel. What happened to Jacob? The names go back and forth all the time, but here they're calling him Israel. And that is his name, but previously in verse 36 of the chapter, it said, the previous chapter says, "And their father Jacob said to them, 'You have bereaved me. And then in verse 6 of this, it says, and Israel said, so it went from their father, Jacob, to Israel. And Israel said, why did you do evil for me to tell the man you still had a brother? So now they call that evil. They were being honest. And they called that, Jacob, or in the form of Israel here, was calling it evil. He was hurt. He was confused. He was hungry. He didn't know what to do. And they said, the man kindly asked about us and about our kindred. Keenly asked about us and our kindred, saying, is your father still alive? Is there a brother to you? And we said to him on the mouth of those words, could we know certainly that he would say, bring down your brother? And Judah said to his father, Israel, send the youth with me, and let us rise up and go, and we may live and not die, both you, I, and the little ones. So Judah here saying, send him with me, the youth. So we don't know, I don't know the exact age here of Benjamin, but they're calling him a youth. Send the youth with me. And Judah is vowing from saying, I will surely for him, you may require from him my hand. If I do not bring him to you and set him before you, I shall be a sinner against you in all the days. So here's Judah's vowing to watch over him and bring him back. And verse 10, if we had not delayed, truly we would be returned twice. And their father Israel said to him, if it be so, then do this. So now his father's thinking again, his manipulative ways of what can be done and how he can do something. And his father says, Israel, his father Israel said to them, their father Israel, if it be so, then do this. Take from the produce of the land in your vessels and bring down a present to the man. A little balm, a little honey, spices, myrrh, nuts, and almonds. Now, remember the famine in the land was severe. And in this little gift here was some balm, you know, some herb there. A little honey, some food there, spices, myrrh, nuts, and almonds. When you don't have food, this is your life, is this food. And they're giving this food. I don't understand if you know the value or if you understand the value of this gift. There was severe famine in the land, and he was given food as this gift. Take from the produce of the land in your vessels and bring down these honey and these spices and these myrrh and nuts and almonds. These were the most valuable possessions because there was no food in the land except for the grain in Egypt. And he said to take down this powerful. But this is the, I wouldn't say the kindness of Jacob or Israel. This is the manipulation of him, trying to manipulate or somehow use something physical. And here, it was again a lack of faith of Jacob. You know, he didn't say, if it be so, may Yahweh be with you and protect you. And at least in this verse, he didn't. He says it later, but he says, if it be so, go and take these presents. Didn't say Yahweh told him to take them. Didn't say Yahweh told him to take the food you have, the last of the food you have, and go down and bring it to them as a gift. This is all Jacob's doing. You know, and then he says, and take in verse 12, and take double silver in your hand, and the silver they put back in the mouth of your sack. Take back your hand. Perhaps it was an oversight. And take your brother and rise up and return to the man. So there's what Jacob. And now he acknowledges Yahweh. And Elohim Almighty, give mercy to you before this the man. And may he send your other brother to you. And Benjamin, and if I am bereaved, I am bereaved. So he finally, after talking about the gifts and telling their sons to do all these things, he finally acknowledges and prays to Yahweh, or prays. May Yahweh be with them. In verse 15. And the men took this present, and they took double of silver in a hand, and Benjamin. And they rose up and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. And Joseph saw Benjamin with them. And he said to the one over his house, bring the men into the house and slaughter and prepare an animal, for the men shall eat with me at noon. So Joseph had this planned out, what was going to happen when they came back. And the man did as Joseph said, and the men brought the men into Joseph's house. And the men were afraid because they were brought into Joseph's house. They weren't confident with Yahweh, they were afraid. And they said, because of the silver that was returned in our sacks before, we are being brought in to throw himself on us and fall on us and take us and our donkeys for slaves. And they came near to the man who was over Joseph's house and spoke to him at the door of the house. And they said, oh, my master, surely we came before to buy our food. And it happened when we came to the camp and opened our sacks, behold, the silver of each was in the mouth of his sack, and our silver on the weight, and we bring it back in our hand. And we have brought other silver in our hand to buy food. We do not know who put the silver in our sacks. And he said, peace be to you. Do not fear. Your Elohim and the Elo of your father has given you a treasure to you in your sacks. Your silver came to me, and he brought Simon out to them. Wow. So this is the man that was over the house. It says, and they said, my master, surely we came before you to buy food. So this is interesting. So it says the men were afraid. In verse 18, they were brought to Joseph's house. And they said, because the silver was returned. So now they're talking amongst each other. And then in verse 19, they came near to the man who was over Joseph's house and spoke to him at the door of the house. And they said, my master, surely we came before to buy food. So now who are they talking directly to, Joseph or the man? So that's a question. But it would seem that they're calling him master. They're talking to Joseph. And it happened when they came into camp and opened the sacks. And they were explaining to this. And in verse 23, it says, and he said, peace. And so he said, and I believe this was Joseph, not the man, peace be to you. Or peace to you. Do not fear. Your Elohim and the Elo of your father has given a treasure to you. Your Elohim and the Elo of your father. Your Elohim and the Elo of your father has given a treasure to you. Powerful. Powerful. Joseph, the foreign king, the so-called foreign king, was acknowledging what exactly was the source of this. Your silver came to me or from me, and he brought Simon out to them. And the men led out the man to Joseph's house. So maybe this wasn't Joseph. Maybe the man was translating for Joseph. Which so it seems now, because now the men were led out to Joseph's house, and he gave water, and they washed their feet and gave fodder to their donkeys. So now they're taking care of his donkeys, and they prepared the present for the coming of Joseph at noon. So this apparently was not Joseph. This was the man who was in charge of Joseph's house. And it's amazing that he spoke their language, where they understood him and he was able to have a conversation. So the men of Israel were having a conversation with the man who was leading Joseph's house. And this could only assume that they knew the language of the people of Israel if that wasn't Joseph. He was telling them what to say. And they prepared a present for the coming of Joseph at noon, for they had heard that they would eat bread there. And Joseph came into the house, and they brought the present in their hand to him into the house. And they bowed to him to the earth. Again, here's the bowing to him. So there's no praying to Yahweh in any of this with these brothers. And he asked them of their welfare, and he said, "Is there peace to your father, the old man of whom you spoke? Is he still alive?" Well, remember what he said, "You'll bring me down to my grave," all of this stuff that's going on. And Joseph asking if he's still alive. And they said, "Peace to you and your servant. Our father, he still lives." And they fell down and bowed. Here they are praising this foreign king. Unlike, remember Daniel and his three friends that refused to bow down to the king? Not Jacob's sons. They were bowing down to the foreign king. They probably would have did anything he said at this point. And he raised his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, the son of his mother. And he says, "Is this your youngest brother, whom you spoke to me?" And he said, "My Elohim favor you, my son. Or may Elohim favor you, my son." And Joseph hurried, for his emotions were deeply moved towards his brother. And he sought a place to weep. And he came into the inner room and wept there. And he washed his face, controlled himself, and went out and said, "Set out bread." And they set out for him by himself, and he sat out for him by himself, and for them by themselves, for the Egyptians eating with him by themselves. For the Egyptians cannot eat bread with the Hebrews, for it is abomination in Egypt. And they sat before him. So technically, you're not allowed to do this. The Egyptians and eating the Hebrews at the same table was considered an abomination, but here they were doing it together. They sat before him, the firstborn according to his birthright, and the young according to his youth. And the men were astonished to each of his neighbor. And they carried the portions from before him to them. And Benjamin's portion was greater than the portions of all of them, five times as much. And they drank and were drunken with him. So they were drink and drunken with him. So drunken with him, does that mean they got drunk together? I don't know what they were drinking, but they were having a feast. They were having a feast. They were doing something that shouldn't have been done. And we're setting ourselves up here for one of the most amazing chapters in scripture, as we're going to see here in chapter 44 tomorrow. But this is the story of what Yahweh's doing, you know. And was Yahweh telling Joseph to do it this way? Poor Jacob was back there just wondering what was going on and worried about his children and worried about Benjamin. But here Benjamin was getting five times the portion of the food that they were invited to eat with the king. Something wasn't right here. But they're going to find out the truth here in the next chapter. Well, chapter 45, we'll find out. But in the next chapter, we're going to find out. They're going to come to climax of this story here. And we'll see that here tomorrow. Praise Yah. lot to take in, this amazing story. All right, everybody, have a blessed day. Have a blessed day. May Yahweh be with you this day, and may your prayers be answered this day. To all of you, Yeshua's name, hallelujah. Thanks for watching, and thanks for your prayers for this ministry, and shalom, shalom.